Pregabalin is the generic name of a drug that we use to treat some types of chronic pain like fibromyalgia and neuropathic pain. In this video, I'll answer 10 common questions that people ask me about pregabalin. Are pregabalin and gabapentin the same? What is the correct dose of pregabalin? How does pregabalin work for pain? Which class of drug is pregabalin? What to do when pregabalin doesn't work for my pain? Does pregabalin cause any damage to the liver or kidneys? Will pregabalin make you sleepy or cause weight gain? Can you drive or can you take alcohol with pregabalin? Is pregabalin good for anxiety? Why pregabalin is not a controlled substance? So let's talk about pregabalin today. Question number one, are pregabalin and gabapentin the same? No. These are two different drugs. Pregabalin is C8, age 17, and O2. Gabapentin is C9, age 17, and O2. Both pregabalin and gabapentin are second generation anticonvulsant medications, and both are classified as gabapentinoids. I have another video that I talk about gabapentin. If you go to the description of this video below, you will see a link to that other video. Pregabalin is more potent than gabapentin and therefore is used at lower doses. Which makes me to the next question. What is the correct dose of pregabalin? The maximum dose per day is 600 milligrams. We use it twice a day, so the maximum would be 300 milligrams in each dose. We usually start at lower doses of 25 milligrams once a day just to let the body adapt to the side effects. Then we tell the person to take twice a day. We increase the dose slowly to give time to see if the person is not too sedated or dizzy. We usually don't see any pain relief at lower doses. The person will notice the pain is better when they can achieve at least 300 milligrams per day, which means 150 milligrams two times a day. Before I continue, let me remind you that this video is not intended to replace medical advice. It is for educational purposes only. You should contact your doctor for proper diagnosis and treatment plan for you. In case of emergency, go to the nearest emergency department or call an ambulance. Number three, how does pregabalin work for pain? Pregabalin binds to receptor in the nerve system and reduces the release of substances that stimulates the pain sensations that arrive at the brain. If you have seen the other videos that I explain what chronic pain is, you will remember that there are ascending pathways from the periphery to the brain and then descending pathways from the brain to the periphery. Well, the gabapentinoids, both pregabalin and gabapentin, they block the ascending pathways. So there are less electrical impulses arriving at the brain level. At the conscious brain. Therefore, the brain will receive less bombarding from impulses arriving from the rest of the body. In addition, pregabalin also mimics the endogenous neurotransmitter GABA. GABA is one of the main inhibitors of nerve and brain activity. When the brain needs to slow down to block some activity, it will release GABA. Well, pregabalin can mimic GABA and suppress a lot of brain activity. That can be a good thing if the person is having pain and anxiety, but it can be a bad thing if the person needs to concentrate and stay alert. Because pregabalin is an anticonvulsant medication, it has antiepileptic properties, so it can be used to treat seizures. So in summary, pregabalin can be used for a variety of conditions. For pain, because it is neuromodulator properties in the pain system, for anxiety, and for seizures. Number four, what class of drug is pregabalin? Pregabalin is an anticonvulsant medication, but we don't use it because the person has seizures. We are using the term neuromodulator. So if someone asks me today what class of medication is pregabalin, I will answer it is a neuromodulator. Number five, what to do when pregabalin doesn't work for my pain? Unfortunately, not everybody with chronic pain will have pain relief with pregabalin. If they don't see at least 30% pain relief, then it's not working for them. It is very rare to achieve 100% pain relief for chronic pain with pregabalin. So here are some reasons why pregabalin is not working for you. First, You didn't get to a high enough dose yet. A lot of patients have to stop early at lower doses because of side effects. 2, if you were on a high enough dose, then it could be that you didn't try for long enough. I tell patients that when you get to the therapeutic dose of at least 300 milligrams per day, then you need to wait between 2 and 6 months for your nerve system to readjust. 3, you are not taking the medication twice a day. I know some patients don't like to take pregabalin in the morning because of the sleepiness and dizziness, but if they only take once a day, then there is no way to know if the drug is benefiting them or not for pain. 4, it may be that the type of pain that you are having is not responsive to pregabalin. There is a recent Cochrane review that summarized 45 randomized controlled trials of pregabalin for neuropathic pain in adults. The conditions that they included in this review were postherpetic neuralgia, painful diabetic neuralgia, mixed neuropathic pain, central pain, HIV neuropathy, back pain with radiculopathy, and neuropathic cancer pain, and painful polyneuropathy. You know what their conclusions were? That there is efficacy of pregabalin in postherpetic neuralgia, painful diabetic neuralgia, and mixed or unclassified post-traumatic neuropathic pain. But there was absence of efficacy in HIV neuropathy and inadequate evidence of efficacy in central neuropathic pain. There is another Cochrane review of pregabalin for fibromyalgia that was updated in 2016. They found 8 randomized trials, and it's interesting that the authors of this review looked at the efficacy outcomes with different doses of pregabalin. They found one study of 263 patients that took only 150 milligrams per day, and there was no benefit of pregabalin compared to placebo. You see that they have to increase the dose to increase the proportion of patients who had good outcome. In this case, at least 30% pain intensity reduction or 50% pain intensity reduction. And it was significantly different from placebo. So they concluded pregabalin 300 to 600 milligrams produced a major reduction in pain intensity over 12 to 26 weeks with tolerable adverse events for a small proportion of patients, about 10% more than placebo, with moderate to severe pain due to fibromyalgia. The degree of pain relief is known to be accompanied by improvements in other symptoms like quality of life and function. The authors of this review also included trials that compared pregabalin to other medications that are approved for fibromyalgia, and they found results are similar of pregabalin to other effective medicines in fibromyalgia, milnacipran and duloxetine. 6, does pregabalin cause any damage to the liver or kidneys? Usually we're not concerned that pregabalin will be toxic to the liver or kidney, even if the person needs to use pregabalin for the rest of their lives. It is important to know if the patient already has a liver kidney function problem before they start using pregabalin, because their dose needs to be adjusted. They will require a lower dose of pregabalin than people who do not have a liver or kidney problem. Which brings me to the next question about the side effects of pregabalin. 7, will pregabalin make you sleepy or cause weight gain? The answer is yes. Most likely yes. The most common adverse effects of pregabalin are dizziness, somnolence, weight gain, leg swelling, and dry mouth. But there are many other potential adverse effects that I am not listing here, as they are too many. Not everybody will have those adverse effects, but they are very common. 8, can you drive or can you take alcohol with pregabalin? The short answer is no. If you feel that you are dizzy and sleepy, you should not be driving a car or operating any heavy equipment. You could cause injury to yourself and others. And taking with alcohol makes you more sleepy and dizzy. 9, is pregabalin good for anxiety? Well, pregabalin has sedating effects, and those can be helpful to people who suffer from anxiety disorders. They're used in combination with other anxiolytic medications to treat generalized anxiety, for example. However, it's important to remember that if a person takes pregabalin every day and they stop abruptly, their body will have withdrawal symptoms. Those abstinence symptoms may include anxiety, insomnia, headaches. But this is not the same thing as being addicted to pregabalin. There is no such thing as addiction to pregabalin. The person may develop dependence, physical dependence, the same way that people can develop physical dependence to thyroid hormones or blood pressure medications. If they stop any of those medications abruptly, they have withdrawal symptoms. It does not mean that they are addicted to their thyroid hormones or blood pressure medications. And number 10, why pregabalin is not a controlled substance. As I explained before, there is no risk of someone getting addicted to pregabalin. I know people may abuse pregabalin, but people can also abuse acetaminophen, anti-inflammatories, or anti-nausea medications. It doesn't mean all these drugs need to be controlled by the government because people abuse them. So, I hope that this answered your 10 top questions about pregabalin. If you like this video, press the thumbs up button here and don't forget to subscribe to this channel and turn on the notifications so you can be alerted when I post new videos on this channel. And watch my next video here. Goodbye!